Starting now. And okay, welcome everyone to the virtual time series seminar. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Anna Mikusheva from MIT. She is joined by guest panelist Mikael Solfsen from ORHUS. We're very happy to have them with us today. Please note that the meeting will be recorded. If you have clarifying questions, please raise your hand or write the question in the chat and we'll relay the questions to the speaker. More substantial questions and comments can be made after the seminar. So without further ado, Anna, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Yes, I'm happy to be here and I'm sure my co-author Mikael is also very happy to see the presentation. This is the first time we present this paper, so it's kind of hot at the moment, maybe even not fully baked. And we do truly appreciate any comments or suggestions you may have. The paper has very short title, but even shorter message, which is, if you're trying to do OLS in time series context, you might be worried. You may have bias, and if in fact you have many regressors, you should be really worried because you really have a huge potential for the bias, and sometimes it might be even inconsistent. So just to describe the setting, we consider the most simple model you can imagine. You run OLS regression using time series data. So you're regressing outcome variable Y on regressors X. Those regressors are k-dimensional. In the principle, we allow K, the number of regressors, grow at most as a proportion of sample size. Since we will be talking about consistency, it's very hard to talk about consistency when the number of parameter grows. We will reduce our attention to a linear contrast. It means that what you do is you run OLS regression, you estimate beta, and then you report some linear combination as a parameter of interest. For example, as a leading case, you may imagine that you're interested in just first coefficient or coefficient on the first regressor. As you probably know, the most commonly used assumption in time series is that of weak exogeneity, when we assume that error today has mean zero conditionally on today's regressor and the whole history of regressors. In principle, it's usually very strongly contrasted with assumption of exogeneity common for cross-section. And cross-section, you use something known as strict exogeneity, where you claim that expectation of error term conditional all regressors is equal to zero. In time series, it's kind of unbelievable. At least it's very hard to come up with economic application where you do have a full strict exogeneity. The common challenge to strict exogeneity is that very often we do have a feedback mechanism, means that outcome variable Y will eventually at some point affect regressors X. At the same time, when we teach our students all good properties of OLS, you may look up, we usually do impose strict exogeneity, and everything we teach pretty much assumes strict exogeneity. For example, unbiasedness. Obviously, for unbiasedness, you do need to be able to condition on the whole X to take the denominator matrix out. It has been known forever that OLS is biased in time series, and we are not the first to say that. However, there is also a common belief among applied researchers that it's biased, but so what? The bias is negligible in a sense that there are theorems claiming that OLS is consistent and asymptotically Gaussian. From that perspective, bias is kind of small. It's there, so, but I don't care. And this belief to some extent has some foundation in textbooks. In every textbook on time series you open, you will find statements about consistency and Gaussianity, but they are derived under very stringent assumptions. Specifically, what you usually assume is that the number of regressors is relatively small. There are usually assumptions about stationarity of them and some moment conditions. Eventually, what you need is X prime X, properly normalized, converged to a non-random matrix. We argue that in applications, people throw many regressors in their regression, and those assumptions do not really that applicable. Our claim is when you consider more and more regressors in OLS time series, you have a huge potential for bias. And when the number of regressors a fraction of sample size, your OLS may be even inconsistent. We think that there are three factors contributing to large biases of OLS. The first one I already mentioned, that is strict exogeneity, is not really an assumption you can use. And here we would show that even very mild violation of strict exogeneity, such as a feedback for one period only, so it means that outcome does affect next regressor, but then disappears, even such mild violation of strict exogeneity will be enough to produce very large biases. The second factor that will be important for us is that in time series, most regressors are autocorrelated. And I will clarify, we do not really need persistence. So this is not a talk about unit roots or alike. What really will be needed for us is just the presence of first order autocorrelation to produce biases. And finally, many regressors. The bias eventually will be proportional to the number of regressors, and OLS we will show may become inconsistent when the number of regressors grows proportionally to the sample size. When we started this project, what was our surprise is how easy it is to get biases in simulations. And so I will show you the simplistic model where you can really see the bias easily. So what we do here is we simulate K independent AR1 processes with parameter rho, then we slightly rotate them so we figure out what the direction of bias, et cetera. That is technicalities you may be not so interested, but essentially we have a K-dimensional AR1 process. We also have completely independent shocks. And so if X tilde would be regressors, that will be strictly exogenous case, everything would be lovely. We introduce weak exogeneity by saying that what you observe X is the strictly exogenous part X tilde plus alpha epsilon T. So this is like previous period shock. So this is one period only feedback mechanism. So the previous time errors affect today regressor and that's it. And then we simulate the correctly specified OLS model, which we estimate by using OLS and then report a linear contrast. So what do we see? Here, the red line is bias of OLS, and dashed line is standard deviation. The setup is with 200 observations. The first display shows when the number of regressors increases, so K goes up. And on the right display, you do see when the autocorrelation coefficient changes. What you can see is that bias really get above the standard deviations very easily. So you really have like about 20 regressors and bias is equal to standard deviations. Some may say, well, but you're using AR1 process, they may be persistent. The truth is that's not about persistence whatsoever. We can see the same results with MI1 process as well. So these are the simulations when the stationary regressors are simulated with really short memory process, MI1. But you have exactly the same bias does increase with first order correlation. And it does increase with a number of regressors and bias become higher than standard deviation very easily. So in this paper, we do two things. First of all, two positive things, I would say. First of all, we do derive the leading term of OLS bias and we discuss why. What factors contribute to it, what the bias look like, and what you should check in your application when you're thinking, do I have a bias? So we will be very directly pointing where it comes from. And second of all, we propose a new estimator that we claim is nearly unbiased. Our estimator, well, we'll derive it for the case when the deviations from strict exogeneity is for one period only and then generalize it for multiple periods. So our estimator uses oblique projections in the same way OLS uses orthogonal projections. If you never thought about oblique projections, I would tell you that OLSs usually, instrumental variable regressions very often look like oblique projections. And so we will sometimes try to explain our estimator is IV motivated, but our IV will be invalid IV. So we will not need an instrument per se. So we produce technical instrument within our system. Specifically, we will use as instrument linear combination between the current regressor and the lead of it. This so-called instrument will not be instrument in real terms. It is endogenous, but it's endogenous exactly when the strict exogeneity is violated. And so we will produce it in such a way that endogeneity bias of IV cancels out with OLS bias, and we end up with almost unbiased estimator. It will not be exactly unbiased, but it will be nearly unbiased. We will show that our estimator is consistent and asymptotically Gaussian. And we will kind of show the formula for the standard deviations. In most settings, we try to simulate both OLS and our estimator and found that there is really no costs for correcting the bias. The standard deviations are almost identical in both cases. So specifically in this simulation settings I just showed to you, the blue line, blue solid line is a bias of our estimator, and blue dashed line is standard deviation of our estimator. And so they're not exactly the same, but they're very close. And when they are not exactly the same, it's not clear which one is better. So the ordering might be arbitrary. So what follows, I will spend a lot of time trying to explain why OLS is biased, because I think at least the first time people hear that, there's like, no, that cannot be true. So I will try to convey that it is true, and I will try to convey why it is true. Then I will present our new estimator. I will talk about resulting consistency, asymptotic Gaussianity. This two middle sections will be mostly about one period violation of strict exogeneity. And then I will talk about multi-period extension. We would appreciate any comments you have about connection of our paper to the literature. That's where we're a little bit lacking right now. So we found at least three strands of literature where we may potentially have connections. The first one is about weak exogeneity and specifically GLS in time series. We do know that there have been a paper by Hansen and West who essentially raised this issue that GLS mixes up timing and it should not be applied under weak exogeneity because it produces big biases. We do think we might be kind of tangentially related to that as well. We do think that we related to large literature on estimation of dynamic effects and panel data and so-called Nickel bias. Does look like we have something in common there. The panel data has its pluses and minuses, a huge help in those papers. Usually the fact that you have multiple entities and they're independent, so you usually load a lot on those independents, but you're trying to solve Nickel bias. And additional factor that helps them a lot is that very often you know why there is a bias, and it's because of estimation of fixed effects, and fixed effects have very specific structures, so you may use the structures like Dimini entry bias. We will be proposing a solution that does not use the structure of the regressor as much. Finally, we do think that we're related to the literature on many instruments. We think the essence of a problem we discovered are very similar to the paper by Becker, who introduced the many instrument idea and kind of modeled the number of instruments as growing, and we will show that. Our inferences are somewhat reminiscent of inferences at many weak IV, specifically that they need central limit theorems for quadratic form, and we do need two, and that's why we reference to those papers. I wonder if there is a question, because I'm kind of ready to go on the big question, why all this is biased.
No questions so far.
Good. Okay. So why all this is biased? I will try to talk about a simpler case. So imagine that I'm interested in this OLS regression. So Y is outcome variable this time series. X is a regressor. Capital T is the number of observations. Capital K is the number of regressors. We would assume that X is what we observe, this observed regressors, but there is a strictly exogenous part in them, X tilde. X tilde is a part of X that is kind of satisfy the strict exogeneity condition. So the error term is conditioning in zero next to them. We also will be maintaining the assumption of homoscedasticity, conditional homoscedasticity. Assume for a moment that in fact, almost all your regressors are strictly exogenous. In fact, all but one, only first regressor is not strictly exogenous. So it means like all but one observed regressors are equal to all but one tilted ones. But the first one has feedback mechanism for one period. What it means? It means that today's value of first regressor is value of its strictly exogenous part plus shock from the period. Okay? And I'm doing Euler's. Obviously, Fritsch-Waugh theorem applies an OLS coefficient. I will be interested in coefficient on this first endogenous, weakly exogenous regressor. And by Fritsch-Waugh theorem, this first coefficient can be estimated as a result of bivariate regression of outcome variable y on partial out regressor x1. Partial out means I do apply projection operator that project out all other regressors. And this is this operator. Notice that I assume that all other regressors are strictly exogenous, which means that this projection operator in fact is quite nice. It's unrelated to epsilons whatsoever, so it is strictly exogenous. I even may treat it as fixed if I condition on them. Okay, this is still Fritsch-Waugh, but the first regressor has epsilon. So projection matrix is nice, but it's large matrix, it's T by T matrix, and it has all elements. And so it kind of mixes up timing. So even though my regressor depended on past shock, once I apply this mixing up of time, it suddenly may become correlated with its own error. And so as a result, I may end up having, Euler's bias. So if I will try to be a little bit accurate thinking about it, what happened? Imagine that MST are the elements of this projection matrix, right? So what I do, in fact, I do have a first part, which is strictly exogenous. And that's beautiful. It has mean zero. There is nothing funny about it. It's like regular thing that you prefer. And then there is a quadratic form in epsilons. This epsilon s minus one comes from the regressor, from the first regressor, and epsilon t comes from the error term, right? And what happened is when these two indices s minus one and t coincide, they have not mean zero. So as a result, for the numerator, the expectation is not zero, but rather this sum. What's this sum? This sum is a lower trace, right? It's not the main trace. So it's not like I'm summing up elements on diagonal. It's I'm summing elements one step below the diagonal. Okay? And so what we see is that numerator has non-trivial mean. Now, I may talk about denominator, but it's not exciting whatsoever. There is nothing funny happening in denominator. Denominator grows as sample size grows. And so eventually I can kind of come up with the main bias term. It has this sum of this low diagonal elements in the numerator, and it has sample size t in the denominator. And my main question may be, but is this lower trace large or not? Do I know anything about it? Apparently, it's very easy to figure out. I would notice that projection matrices do not depend on linear transformation of regressors. So I may pick up whatever linear transformation I wish. I will normalize regressors. So x tilde prime x tilde divided by t is equal to identity matrix just for simplicity. So I will kind of standardize them. Then this lower diagonal, in fact, will correspond to kind of predictability of next regressor by today's regressor. So like first order of the covariance, roughly. And remember, my regressors are k vectors. It means that their length is k. And so if they on average, for example, have correlation coefficient of rho, I should expect that my low diagonal will be approximately rho k. Also notice that in cross-section, you do not have such a problem. Because in cross-section, elements with different indices are independent from each other. And as a result, sums of almost all diagonals are zero, except the main one for projection matrix. But in time series, we do have a lot of correlations, so we do have this issue. So as a result, if only first regression is weakly exogenous, the Bayes leading theorem has this form, and I describe why. What we see? We see that if rho is separated from zero and k is a fraction of sample size, then this leading Bayes term in fact converges to a constant asymptotically. And as a result, the beta 1-hat is inconsistent. It's converging to a wrong place. I would also notice that obviously you may say, well, how often do I have the number of regressors of fraction size? Well, it depends on what you think fraction is, right? So when you have 200 observations, it's kind of very common to have at least 20 regressors, and that's 10% of the sample size, to tell the truth. We do think that it's a lot. It's a lot. But even if k grows slower than t, but takes faster than square root of t, and standard deviation grows at square root of t, then obviously your bias will start dominate standard deviation at some point and probably very early. And so as a result, we do see that bias may in fact dominate what's happening here. I should also notice that essentially all other coefficients we can show are nearly unbiased. So it's only beta one, the coefficient on weakly endogenous regressor happen to be problematic. You may say, okay, so you had this special case. What is in general case? The truth is this special case is a general case because Euler's is have this invariance to linear transformations if, as long as your linearly transformed contrasts as well. So we kind of can imagine that you rotate your regressors to such extent that the first one become this weakly exogenous one. And we do have a very general result about the first order bias in Euler's. So it is derived under these assumptions. And the most important one is the first assumption. It's assumed that why your regressor is not strictly exogenous, it's because it has one period feedback. So that is the main part of it. So we consider a case when it is one period feedback. But other than that, X tilde are strictly exogenous regressors and it has full rank. So that's like, strictly exogenous part is this part. Notice that we put very little assumption on regressors, in fact. We just require that it's full rank. We do not ask that it's stationary. We do not put any moment condition. We do not claim that they obey any limit theorem whatsoever. We do need some moments of error term. Alpha, this vector alpha is a direction of a feedback mechanism. Usually you do not know it. We make only assumption that it's not dominating everything. So essentially alpha cannot be the whole regressor. So there is an exogenous part of it and that's what assumption about this happens. R is the direction of contrast we're trying to estimate. We also need this piece. So at least there is a possibility of consistent estimator of a contrast. We assume that the number of regressors may grow. We do not control at what speed they grow, but it's less than the full sample size. And we do need that T minus K diverge to infinity. So we kind of imagine that at most it grows as a fraction, maybe. So under this assumption, what we can derive is this theorem. So again, you try to estimate the contrast linear combination by using Euler's, and this is a true parameter. It has a leading bias term. We derive this leading bias term and everything else is asymptotically negligible. Linear bias term, let me describe what's staying here. There is lambda. Lambda is describing how important is violation to strict exogeneity. So it is parameter that describes the size of alpha. So if there is no violation of strict exogeneity, so alpha is equal to zero, if there is no feedback, lambda will be zero, bias will be zero. That's what we mean. This size is between zero and one. It's a little bit like what part of the weakly exogenous regressor is described by the feedback mechanism. New parameter is measuring how contrast we're trying to estimate is aligned with the feedback mechanism alpha. Notice when I gave you the example, I said, imagine that the first regressor is weakly exogenous, and then I showed that the coefficient on the first regressor is biased. And I also claimed that almost anyone else who is perpendicular to the first regressor will not be biased that much. So essentially, bias of linear combination only depends on how much you load on this weakly exogenous regressor. And that is captured by nu. Lambda and nu both depend on this feedback mechanism alpha, which you usually have no idea about. So you don't know what it is. And we will not assume that you know it. But there is a last piece, and that's the piece I kind of discussed the most already. It's a low diagonal trace divided by T minus K. And this piece is observed in data. You may just go and calculate the projection metrics and calculate it low diagonal and see if it's large or not. So alpha is not known and cannot be accessed. So lambda and nu, we will not try to assess them, but we can assess how big is the potential for bias measured by this ratio. And our solution will not be attempting to estimate alpha, but rather to close this channel. I will stop. Probably there is a question. Is there a question?
Yes, there is a question in the Q&A from Otilia Baldea. So let me read it. I wonder if you are aware of this working paper by Pierre Perron that shows, in fact, quasi-differencing, adding a lag of XT or effectively a GLS transformation, sometimes absolves us of the need to have strictly exogenous regressors.
We are not aware of that paper, and I think we would be greatly appreciate if you can send us a link. Yeah.
No other questions.
Thank you very much. Okay, so then I will start talking about our proposal. So when I will be talking about the simplistic version of our proposal, it will be only affecting case when there is one period violation of strict exogeneity. And what we propose to use oblique projection in the place of orthogonal projection that is used by OLS. What is oblique projection? So this is oblique projection on axis. This is oblique projection off axis. This projection operator is nilpotent in the sense that their square is equal to themselves, but they're typically not symmetric. Symmetric nilpotent matrices are orthogonal projections. We will pick up direction of projection Z as a linear combination of today's regressor and future. It's lead. For any gamma, we can produce such an estimator. Not all of them will be good though. If I would produce such an estimator, I might ask what bias of it? How big is the bias here? Why are we using oblique projection? Partially, there is a generalization of Frisch-Wein. In fact, it's exactly the same. So if you're interested in the first coefficient, we kind of suspect that the first coefficient will be the problematic one in the same special case when only first regressor is weakly exogenous. We consider it as a bivariate regression, oblique regression of outcome variable on X using Z as a direction. But here we would use oblique projections as well. So like realistically, this theorem is still holds. Again, if we assume that all regressors but the first one are strictly exogenous, this matrix is good. They produce nothing bad. You can condition on them. We will be looking on numerator because we know that's where the problem is. if my first regressor is having this feedback mechanism, then my first Z will have two epsilons. That's because I'm using today's X and future X. So it will be mixing up epsilon T minus one and epsilon T. When I look on my numerator, that's here, again, I will have a strictly exogenous part, which is beautiful. It has min zero, it's like regular thing. And I have a quadratic form. But now my quadratic form have two terms. And it's also using different projection metrics, I can tell you. And so I can write the leading term of a Bayesian denominator for this oblique projection, it's here. So what I did so far, I suggest that let's do oblique projection in this direction Z, which mixes up two consecutive observation today's in the lead, and use this estimator. The Bayes term has this form. The idea is let's choose gamma in such a way to make this term zero. Intuitively, why it is possible? It is possible because these elements are diagonal elements, main diagonal elements. These elements are low diagonal elements. Low diagonal elements in general, less than main diagonal elements. And so I kind of theoretically may potentially solve this equation, find gamma that makes this trace zero. And when I do that, I close this potential channel for bias. Okay. Our estimator has instrumental variable interpretation. We do not insist on it because it's a bad instrumental variable if you think about that as instrumental variable. We produce a technical instrument, means we don't need anything from outside. We produce technical instrument by mixing up today X and future X. And this instrument is invalid. It's endogenous exactly when the strict exogeneity is violated. And it is exogenous when it's not. So more than that, it's kind of producing bias in the same direction as OLS because it's producing bias in the direction of weak violation of strict exogeneity. And so we do select gamma to cancel these two biases, cancel the bias of IV with bias of OLS. That's the idea. Now we will present this idea in a kind of more general case in the matrix form, but all equations you have seen with summations in fact can be written in matrix forms as such. We will use D. This is a low diagonal matrix. You may say that's a lead lag matrix. So if you apply it to time series, it shifts everyone by one period to the past. So this is a matrix that have ones on diagonal just below the main one, and everything else is zero. D prime or transpose D will be lead operator. That's kind of shifts time series to the lead one period ahead. So Z, our instruments are X minus gamma lead of X, or can be written in matrix forms like here. Gamma is this low diagonal matrix with gamma on low diagonal. So our IV can be written in this form. And we choose gamma in such a way that the low diagonal trace is equal to zero. And that's exactly the equation I showed you before. It's interesting that here the projection matrix in fact is oblique projection as well. And that's because of the Frisch-Wohr using the oblique projection here. The question is, can I solve this equation? And the answer is, well, yes, but it's not like obviously can be seen because this equation happened to be a nonlinear equation. Why it's nonlinear? Well, this entrance of gamma is linear, but this entrance of gamma is nonlinear because it appears in denominator of oblique projection. And so it kind of a priori have not been obvious that you can always solve this equation, but we show you can. So as long as X prime X is full rank matrix and sample size is 5 times the number of regressors, this equation always solvable. You may feel a little bit uneasy and saying like, well, you're always talking about many instruments, but then you impose that the sample size is 5 times bigger than the number of instruments. Isn't that restrictive? It is, but mostly because we assume absolutely nothing about regressors except that they're full rank. That's a generality that's not really happening in practice. Once we start a little bit regularizing this X tilde, we may get something better. Specifically, if we look on the lower diagonal, the problem we have originally, and it's not too severe, so like here, mu may be less than one, significantly less than one, then in fact, the requirement on sample size reduces quite a bit, and we also can show that gamma will be relatively small as well. So when the problem is small, to start with, gamma will be small. And so it's kind of, and we have less restrictions on sample size. We also can show that solution to this equation, nonlinear equation, can be written as a fixed point of contraction. And we specifically write the contraction that you need to solve. And obviously it's converges very fast. We have not seen many problems with finding solutions of equations like that thus far. I think I can pause for a little bit if there are any questions or comments.
No questions so far.
Okay. So then I'm ready to talk a little bit about asymptotics of our estimator. We will be using exactly the same assumptions under which we derived the leading term of bias in OLS, which we think is very, very mild. Again, we only assume that there is a one period violation of strict exogeneity. Strictly exogenous regressors, the only assumption we impose is full rank. We do ask for several moments of error terms, and that's pretty much what is there. So for any fixed gamma, we can do this oblique projection, and that would be this estimator. We can write a leading bias part. This is the formula. It looks very much like formula of OLS because OLS is a special case here. When gamma equal to zero, we do get OLS. So that's where we get OLS bias formula as well. So here there is like this lambda gamma parameter between zero and one that characterizes how important this feedback. There is nu that kind of characterizes how well contrast we're estimating is aligned with feedback mechanism. And then there is this trace piece divided by T minus K. If we pick up gamma that solves that this bias term is zero, then our estimate is consistent. Now, there is a little bit of technical caveat. The X tilde is denoting the strictly exogenous part, and that's not what we observe. We observe X, and X is a little bit disturbed, right, by feedback mechanism. Since we don't know the feedback mechanism, is kind of, we do not observe X tilde. But gamma we're trying to find is solving this infeasible equation that use strictly exogenous regressors. Obviously, it cannot be done. What we do in practice, we solve feasible equation that uses the true observed x's. From that perspective, what we use as gamma is can be called gamma hat. It's random and it's endogenous because it depends on all error terms. But realistically, that's minor. We proved that they're very close. In fact, the gamma hat is super consistent estimator for the gamma. And it does not affect the asymptotic distributions of our estimator. So, we do have some results on Gaussianity. For that, we do need to restrict in some assumptions. We do need some assumption like Winterberg conditions, trying to assume the negligibility of each observation. We also need high moment conditions. Something like that will be required for OLS as well, whenever you prove consistency of OLS, if you want to prove it. I should say that OLS usually will require less moments than we do, and I will explain in a moment why. Then under these assumptions, what we will have is that our estimator will be asymptotically Gaussian. And we do have a formula for conditional variant sigma t. The formula, you may say, well, it's a little bit ugly, and I probably would agree with you. It's a long formula. This formula here, in fact, doesn't have all terms we have. It's written for the case when errors are Gaussian, and I will discuss in a moment why. How do I read this formula? The first term here, this one, in fact, super standard. That's what you would do when you write IV or OLS. That's like, that's the linear piece, the usual thing. So that's the most natural part. What is not natural part is the second part. Why it appears because there is a quadratic form. I will remind you where I started. We started with OLS, right? And in denominator, there were two terms. One was linear term, and I said, tau. That's a beautiful, pure vanilla stuff. And then there is a second term, which in fact is a quadratic term in epsilon. That was the term that was problematic because it was producing the bias. It has like non-trivial mean. So we transformed to demean it. So like we removed the mean from that. So we killed the bias, but the term itself remains. And more than that, it has non-negligible uncertainty. And so we now need to account for this quadratic term more accurately, and that's what is done here. This part, in fact, is super, super similar to the literature on many instrument, many regressors, and we do cite some papers here that provide different theorems of central limit theorem for quadratic forms, and that is very helpful for us as well. That's how you should think about that. If error is non-Gaussian, there will be two more terms related to skewness and kurtosis. They are coming from diagonal elements in this quadratic form being epsilon squared. And so eventually that's why we have more moments or require more moments than OLS, for example. At the same time, even though the formula look ugly, and I will be kind of on board with you that it is not the pleasant one, the order of uncertainty we have is essentially the same as in OLS under strict exogeneity. So if you assume that all regressors are strictly exogenous, then what you expect as a variance is this piece on top of this fraction. And it is essentially the same as what our standard errors are in rate. So as a rate, they are kind of not far apart. In simulations, we do not see much of a difference so far in standard deviations of a new estimator and the standard deviation of OLS, but OLS is much, much, much more biased. That is the point. You should remember that what you know about optimality of OLS probably also have been derived under strict exogeneity. So it's not like you a priori would prefer OLS all the time in time series. It's absolutely not clear why would you do that. Another good point to stop and see if there are any concerns.
No questions so far? Oh, no, sorry, there is one. So let me read it. Is ARMA-11 OLS of the AR coefficient biased? So it's solved using MLE. Is this similar to that used? I think maybe this is a little more this is a little more substantial. Maybe we leave this to the end. Yeah, so, sorry about that.
Okay. Yes, let's postpone it to that. I think we have not too much left. The introduction of our estimator and the whole discussion, in fact, is for the case when there is one period violation of strict exogeneity, and that's what we used. Obviously, once you saw that, you may say, well, what if it's more than one? And so we do have generalization for more than one. Specifically, imagine that there is a feedback lasting L periods, and L is some fixed number. So our x, the observed regressor, is x tilde plus L lags of outcome variable times alpha prime. Alpha now is a is a matrix, it's K by L, and kind of contains L directions of feedback mechanism. So one for each lag. As you can imagine, doing exactly the same as before, we can show that Euler's bias have L terms. Each one of them contain the sum of lower diagonals. So you start with the first diagonal below the main one, and then the second, and et cetera. So you're kind of going down the matrix. And so all those diagonals will be contributing. And they will be coming with low, the trace of lower diagonal will essentially be corresponding to average measure of L order autocorrelation of regressors. Since we working with or thinking to work with economic time series, we usually do expect those autocorrelations decay. And sometimes if you have not much of a long memory, then they would probably decay quite fast. So even though there are other biases, they probably will be smaller and smaller with each lag. So to fix it, we would propose essentially to do again oblique projection, but now as a direction oblique projection, we will be mixing up current regressor with L leads of regressor. And each lead will have its own coefficient gamma L, which we will put in vector gamma. Gamma is L time one vector. It does contain these weights we put on different leads. The formula for estimator exactly the same as before. And what we will need is we will try to find this gamma vector. It has gamma, it has L parameters such that it solves a system of L equations. What equations, they look very much like equation I showed you before, but now it's going on the low and lower diagonal. So it kind of take this matrix one minus gamma M gamma and do look at traces of L low diagonals. So we're trying to make them zero. We do have a theorem with slightly updated assumption, assumption one, comma, I guess. The only difference from what before is that we allow L period feedback. That's the only difference. What we can prove is that for vector gamma, this is the leading term of a bias of our oblique projection estimator. I haven't written all the formulas because now nu and lambda will be vectors and matrices that doesn't look as pretty anymore. But important part here is R gamma, which contains though traces. These are the traces. So we have L traces. This R is what before was T minus K scalar, and now it's kind of matrix normalization. In any case, if we find vector that solves the system of equations, then our estimator will be consistent again. And the question is, can we solve this system? And again, we kind of claim we can. If these lower traces are not super big and we characterize it by mu k, so how fast they decay, then we can find a unique solution when the sample size is bigger than this expression, whatever this expression is. The solution can be found as a fixed point of a contraction, and we explicitly write the contraction. The problematic part here, and I want to be very open about it, is that this, at least this statement says the solution when T is bigger than at least K times L. And that might kind of reduce your ability to correct, or you will feel it may reduce your ability to correct. We think that it's just the reminiscence of how we prove it. So we prove it in too much of generality, and we don't think that this condition is necessary. It's just a sufficient condition. In practice, you just go and check, do you solve that or not? And I'll bet in most cases you will solve it. at least again, we ourselves didn't face too much of an issue with finding the solutions. One question that is still open and we are thinking how to address it, probably we'll address it in later draft, is now I know all that. For how many legs to correct, or for like how to choose L. And we want to have very kind of empirically relevant discussion about that, but we do know the potential for bias during to feedback mechanism at period J. It is this trace. So if you worry that there is a feedback at period J, you may just go and look on the G slow diagonal of projection matrix and see if it's large or not. If it's kind of small, you know, well, maybe the worst bias will not be there anyway. So I will have bias, but I don't care that much. We also feel that in most cases, the scale on which you should measure bias is probably the standard deviation scale. At least then you kind of know whether your confidence sets are approximately rightly placed. And the scale of standard deviations is usually 1/√T-K. So eventually, probably when you have an application, this is the number trace of J's diagonal over √T-K is the quantity at which you want to look at and think if you're concerned or not. And in some applications, you will be concerned, in some applications, probably not. But the important part is it is observable. So as a future work that we haven't fully done yet is we plan to derive formal bound that will help to guide your choice of L in that direction. And now I want to summarize what you have seen so far. So the message we try to convey is that a typical time series OLS with large number of regressors may, and in some cases will have bias. When you have a feedback mechanism, and that's pretty much everywhere in macroeconomic applications. So almost always you have feedback mechanism. We characterized that bias typically depend on three factors: on weak exogeneity, how big is it, how big this feedback, and where it's located. It does depend on autocorrelation of regressors, how predictable regressor by its lags, and the number of regressors. The important part is that you do know, or you do know now, how to assess the potential size for the bias by looking on the lower trace, and that if the lower trace is large, you should be probably worried. We think that our paper is positive because we proposed a new estimator. Our new estimator is based on oblique projection. What's interesting, and I want to pay special attention here, is that we proposed this correction by looking only on regressors without looking on outcome variables. So it is how to kind of mix up the regressors to make oblique projection working well. So we have not attempted to estimate feedback mechanism or somehow adapt to the feedback mechanism. And we think it's good because then the same approach, the same oblique projection will work for any outcome variable as long as like they satisfy this restriction that feedback mechanism is only for one period before in the L periods or something like that. We do think that our estimator is consistent under very mild assumptions. We also showed the asymptotic Gaussianity. And what was surprising is that the standard deviations is super comparable to that of OLS. If you really like OLS, you should like our proposal even more probably. We introduced the estimator for one period violation of strict exogeneity, but we showed that it can be generalized for fixed number of periods. And what again, we still have to do is diagnostics for how many periods you should try to correct. And I reached the end of my slides. If there are any questions, you can ask easy questions from me or hard questions from Mikkel.
Very good. Thank you so much, Anna. That was a wonderful presentation. So I will stop the recording now, and we can move to the informal bit.